introduction. Throughout recorded history, the humans of Faerun have feared the Scaled Ones, those sentient snakes and lizard races whose cultures, magic weapons, cities, and visible accomplishments rival those of humanoids. Fireside terror tales tell of slithering death, unblinking eyes, and fangs in the night, and a few even hint at the Serpent Folk's fell plans to enslave all other races and breed them like cattle. Some people scoff at such dark shadow talk, but the wisest sages warn that these fears have a solid foundation. Some few even claim that it's too late to be afraid, because undercover enslavement already exists in many of Faerun's proudest cities. Merchants in Waterdeep and Silver Marshes readily trade rumors of Nagas and snakehead humans who rule southern cities and jungles down there, a swarm with many-headed snakes as long as barges. But in Kalimshan, the Vilhon Reach, and more southernly lands, talks of the Scaled Ones is far more guarded. All across Faerun, those who live closer to the fabled reptilian cultures tend to be far more reticent to speak of them aloud than those who live further away. Although farmers and stay-at-home crafters in most of Faerun's human-dominated realms know nothing of the Scaled Ones beyond the tales told in taverns, many far-traveled folk are convinced that malevolent serpent beings are at work behind the scenes. They're just not quite sure where or how. Even traders who frequent the southernly lands are loath to speak directly of such creatures, lest they draw undue attention to themselves. Though merchants are quick to warn inexperienced servants and traveling companions about odd-smelling smoke, especially if it has a green or purple hue, strange piping sounds arising from cellars and sewers, and wines or sweets tainted with exotic flavors. They usually reply to direct questions with cryptic remarks such as, "Prowling evils never sleep." Serpent Kingdoms focuses primarily on the mysterious scaled creator race, known as the Saruk, and the three major races its members bred and modified into their present forms from more primitive ancestors: Lizard Folk, Nagas, and Yuan-Ti. Various other monsters and races native to Toril, including the Asabi, Ophidians, Petra Folk, Tren, and Troglodytes, are also examined in some detail. The Progenitors. Toril has been home to reptilian creatures of both serpent, legless, and the lizard-limbed kinds ever since the mists lifted from the newly formed continents. Sages believe that before the coming of dragons, much of Faerun's dry land was dominated by creatures that some humans called Thunderers. Lizards ranging from a few inches in length to the size of the biggest ocean-going ships that humankind has since constructed. Amid this flourishing profusion of reptiles were certain kinds of sentient lizards and snakes that developed societies, mastered magic, and eventually built empires. In this ancient time, the lizard people known as the Saruk rose to become the dominant race of Faerun. Through their superior intellect and tactical sense, they forged the land empires known as Istosififil, Mihalishuk, and Okoth, vast realms wherein they enslaved, bred, and experimented upon other creatures. The Saruk dwelt in fortresses, kept thousands of slaves, and built a culture the like of which has never been seen since. Eventually, however, the empires of the Saruk met the inevitable fate of all empires. They slipped into decadence and were ultimately swept away by foes from within and without. Today, some 36,000 years later, the Saruk are very rare but not quite extinct. The few that are left remain as aloof from the rest of Toril as their ancestors were at the height of their power. In fact, most beings in modern-day Faerun have never even heard of them. The creations of Saruk, however, still flourish in many parts of Eirin. The most notable of these are the Yuan-Ti, the Nagas and lizard folk, but horrific and thankfully rarer reptilian monsters with strange shapes and deadly powers have been sighted by intrepid adventurers across the continent. Many of the Nagas and Yuan-Ti experiment on themselves and other creatures just as the Saruk did on them, in hopes of granting themselves and their servitors even greater powers. The ever-expanding humanoid influence on Faerun has done little to check the spread of the Scaled Ones, and even those that lack the means and desire for self-improvement persist and sometimes flourish in remote areas. The Thunderers and other ancient primitive kinds of Scaled Ones were hunted nearly to extinction by dragons, but a few such creatures still survive in remote jungle areas and on offshore islands. Though vast empires controlled by Scaled Ones no longer exist in the surface of Faerun, sentient serpent folk and scaly kind are not the rare perils that humans would like to believe they are, nor are they confined to tombs and ruins. Through spies and direct influence, the covert reach of the Scaled Ones extend to surprising places, including the glittering hearts of Faerun's wealthiest, busiest cities. The insidious threat. Neither the Saruk nor their most capable creations are stupid, though they view humanoids as weak, stinking, ugly, edible cattle. They also recognize that the Scaleless Ones are swift and intelligent, breed rapidly, and can rise to nearly any challenge. Indeed, humans in particular are perhaps the most adaptable of all races of Faerun, making them dangerous but valuable slave material. Thus, though most Yuan-Ti and Nagas in Faerun today view humans and their kin as potential food and slaves, they realize that these creatures also constitute the most dangerous foes. Energetic and widespread, humanoids are too numerous to be confronted openly, but too useful and powerful to be allowed to flourish freely. Indeed, the races spawned by the Saruk are always seeking to expand their influence among humanoids, usually in subtle ways. The ideal. In a perfect serpentfolk-controlled community, humanoids would eagerly serve as slaves, watching for perils that would endanger their serpentine masters, and acting swiftly on their own initiative to deal with such threats and warn their masters of danger. Furthermore, the controlled humanoids would willingly offer themselves as sacrifices to the snake god Seth, and live only to give pleasure and contentment to their masters. In practice, however, Scaled Ones know quite well that no such perfect community can exist, because by their very nature, slaves are weak and imperfect creatures. Covert control. The drive to dominate is characteristic of a Scaled One's cultures, and this need, more than any other facet of their society, makes them an insidious threat to humanoids. To the Yuan-Ti, direct or indirect control of other beings is the sacred way of Seth, the only proper way to deal with other races, whereas to Nagas, it is both prudent and the most favored style of behavior. The Yuan-Ti developed a special terminology to indicate the exact status of Scaleless Ones with whom they have contact, the Tsa-Olo, are potential slaves, usually human, though this term can be applied to any Scaleless One, and sometimes even to other Scaled Ones, as a term of contempt. The Hasar are creatures currently being influenced or conquered, and the Slim are controlled servitors or slaves. The Scaled Ones' attempt to gain control over a humanoid culture include a high degree of covert activity. Both Nagas and Yuan-Ti dwell among humans, subtly influencing and enslaving them through magic, drugs, and controlled servitor creatures, including the altered humans known as Tainted Ones. Rulers and other powerful individuals, such as mighty wizards, are usually the first targets in a given culture, since control of such persons makes domination of the rest of the community simpler. Most of the time, these techniques are used so subtly as to be unnoticeable, Indeed, a tired or uninquisitive humanoid visiting a settlement controlled by serpent creatures may not notice anything out of the ordinary at all. More alert travelers might experience a feeling of being watched or notice an odd local custom, seemingly practiced by everyone, of perfuming the body with strongly scented oils. Merchants who become aware of serpent influence either avoid the affected places altogether, or try to trade with the local citizens for whatever drugs, herbs, and venoms they can obtain. The serpent creatures controlling the servitor humans may offer the desired goods eagerly in order to take control of the merchants or expand their influence to areas beyond their direct control. Neither Yuan-Ti nor Nagas are foolish enough to show their true forms openly in any human settlement they don't control. Thus, when dwelling in or visiting humanoid-dominated settlements, most sentient serpent creatures remain hidden, either behind walls in countryside compounds that they control as absolute rulers, or in slither tunnels built into the walls of settlements. Such passages almost always link up the other tunnels and cellars into a large network of underground routes that are difficult for humanoids to traverse. Sewers, disused and expanded burial catacombs, and storage cellars under humanoid cities, particularly in the warmer parts of Faerun, are also favored dwelling places for scaled ones who are interested in humans. The scaled ones are patient, ever-present and ruthless. Their advance is often very slow and subtle, extending over generations of humans. Often they seek to change local beliefs and attitudes so that service to, and even worship of, Yuan-Ti or Nagas comes to be seen as right, proper, and even holy, regardless of which human deities are locally venerated. Wise scaled ones never rush or act openly. Rather, they patiently await just the right moment to strike. When they do make their moves, they enact precisely the best strategy with cold calm to achieve the maximum possible effect. Yuan-Ti. The Snakeheads, as the Yuan-Ti are generally known, are widely feared among humans. In places where these creatures have been discovered, the residents are justly fearful, and every ruin, sewer, and shadow is seen as a potential hiding place for fell serpent folk who wait to feed on the unwary. The truth, however, is a little different. Overview. The Yuan-Ti are the most powerful, successful, and favored creations of the Sarku. Bred to be loyal and capable servants of their creators, they were trusted to act on their own initiative in furthering their scaly master's agendas. Among the tasks that fell to the Yuan-Ti were the exploration and exploitation of new territory, and the supervision and discipline of lesser servants. To better manage these widely varying responsibilities, the Saruk bred several strains of Yuan-Ti, each with a physical form suited for a particular sort of task. To aid in the creation of servitor races, the Saruk also developed and mastered a technique that would permanently alter the shape of any scaled one. All Yuan-Ti are highly intelligent, self-centered, and calculating. To humans, the typical Yuan-Ti seems ruthless, arrogant, wholly calm, patient, and prepared. Some, however, particularly those who operate alone or with non-scaled servitors, can become crazed and downright reckless. Description. Saruk controlled breeding and the centuries of free-willed mating that followed have established three basic natural forms for the Yuan-Ti. the pure blood, the half-blood, and the abomination. Details of these three kinds of Yuan-Ti, which make up the bulk of the race, can be found in the Yuan-Ti entry on page 262 of the Monster Manual. A few other Yuan-Ti forms also exist, though their numbers are few. Pure Bloods. Yuan-Ti that can pass for humans with suitable clothing, cosmetics and magic are known as Pure Bloods. These creatures are usually charged with infiltrating humanoid societies and managing covert operations that require direct contact with humanoids. Half-Bloods. A Yuan-Ti that possesses such obvious serpentine features as a fully scaled body, snakes instead of arms, a snake head, a snake tail or serpent tail in place of legs is called a half-blood. Half-bloods form the bulk of Yuan-Ti community's defense. Abominations. An abomination either resembles a human-sized snake in every way or has only a single human-like feature, typically a head or arms. Indeed, the classic Yuan-Ti featured in the fireside tales told among humans is a scaled snake with human-like arms. This fearsome creature can invariably speak human languages and glide along upright so as to reach the height of a human. Many such stories erroneously claim that these fearsome creatures can shape change at will into pure bloods, often beautiful human-like females, whose snake blood is revealed only when they seduce human men or when their bodies are accidentally revealed. The truth behind such tales, of course, is that spells can enable any Yuan-Ti to transform temporarily into human form. Anathemas. Above and apart from most Yuan-Ti is the rare anathema, which resembles a great human-armed snake with six human heads. Such a creature possesses formidable powers and is thought to be a divine incarnation of Seth, the Yuan-Ti god. Almost all anathemas attract their own cults of Yuan-Ti who revere and dwell with them. These nascent tribes often outlive their founders to become lasting harasmas, great tribes. These fell creatures I've described fully in the Fiend Folio. Other Yuan-Ti subraces. The Saruk also bred and developed a handful of Yuan-Ti specifically to perform certain specialized tasks. Through the centuries, these subraces, known as Megaslayers and Holy Guardians, have bred true, see chapter 6 for description, racial history, created by the Saruk in the long-ago days of Miharishuk Empire. The first Yuan-Ti were the results of controlled breeding experiments that melded early humans with serpents and Saruk. Altered and augmented by Saruk magic, they became the most powerful and successful of the created scaled races, more intelligent than the lizard folk, and more loyal and versatile than the Nagas. The Saruk favored the Yuan-Ti over these other creations, and entrusted them with the most challenging tasks, those that required free will. By and large, the Yuan-Ti were happy to serve in such capacities, as the depth and fervor of Seth worship grew among them. Carefully manipulated by certain Saruk through generations of Yuan-Ti breeding, the Yuan-Ti increasingly viewed such service as right and fitting, the only proper aim and pursuit of their kind. Yet the very growth of intellect, society, and faith among the Yuan-Ti inevitably weakened their obedience to their creators. At one time, the Saruk held the power to compel obedience from individual Yuan-Ti, regardless of their personal wishes, but the creators gradually lost that ability as Yuan-Ti society grew stronger. The Saruk still retained their power to alter Yuan-Ti bodies at will, however, and to this day they can still coerce individual Yuan-Ti into service by threatening to use this power against them. As their civilization grew, Yuan-Ti began to covet the powers, possessions, and influence of the Saruk. Though they admired Saruk society and embraced its values and worldview, including the fact that lesser beings were meant to be slaves to their betters, they also came to see the Saruk as lazy, decadent and inattentive. The UNT had always taken pride in their own accomplishments as players in Sarug society, but increasingly they saw themselves as more worthy of Seth's favor and rewards than their creators, and began to resent their domination by lesser beings. Eventually, the Miharshuk Empire had weakened enough that outside forces, most notably dragons, decided to launch a concerted attack. These enemy forces crushed many of the Sarug's lizard folk armies, most of which were led by UNT. This bloodbath led some UNT to turn against their creators, and the three great empires of the Sarug fell one by one. The dumbfounded Sarug fled, hid, sank into hibernation, or perished. The UNT were free at last. Or rather, they were free within the confines of their own customs and thinking. Over the centuries that followed, most UNT forgot the Sarug and came to consider themselves the most capable and powerful of beings in all Faerun. They felt that their eventual rise to world domination was inevitable if they went about that task properly. In recent times, however, increasing numbers of UNT have felt the call of the awakened Sarug and trembled at what it might mean. The first unsettling revelation was that the UNT can't resist the call. They are inexorably drawn to the Sarug. The second was the discovery that the Sarug can still alter UNT bodies at will. Specifically, they can slay UNT merely by changing her into a creature that can't breathe air. Thus, they can easily coerce one of their former servants into undertaking any task, regardless of the consequences to her life, social standing, and race. The third and most devastating revelation was that the UNT still want to serve the Sarug on a level far deeper than their conscious minds. The fawning and genuflecting that most UNT find themselves performing in the presence of their old masters is far more than save one's skills play acting. It is the unfailing devotion of a servant to a master. Outlook. To the UNT, their race represents the pinnacle of sentient life. These confident, arrogant creatures see themselves as the most capable and cunning beings on Toril. They believe themselves the rightful masters of all Faerun, and are convinced that they can realize their goal of absolute mastery if they proceed deftly and wisely. In order of importance, UNT rank themselves first, their intimates and battle comrades second, their immediate kin third, their tribe fourth, and their race fifth. Prudence tempers their innate sense of superiority only slightly, causing them to treat Sarug with wary respect. Nagas and obviously formidable scaly creatures, such as dragons and powerful wizards, with guarded politeness. Other serpentine and reptilian beings as useful dupes or short-time allies, and all other creatures as cattle to be used as practicality demands. Some UNT maintain that any creature that defies or disobeys a UNT must either be destroyed or broken to obedience. However, the goal of the race as a whole is to conquer and enslave others, not to butcher or eradicate them. All creatures have their uses, and when the UNT achieve their rightful mastery over all life, the other races will serve as the slaves they were meant to be. After all, there is no victory or proud achievement in ruling a land that has been emptied of other life. Seth teaches that the UNT are destined to rule all, not slay all. Older UNT tend to be more interested in the diversity of the creatures found in Faerun than their younger counterparts, but less tolerant of religious differences and circumstances that might suggest a change in UNT practices. Younger UNT are usually disgusted by direct dealings with other races, particularly when touching is involved, but more tolerant of proposed changes in UNT customs than their elders are. Furthermore, the younger the UNT, the more interest it is likely to exhibit in different worldviews held by other creatures. Only rarely does a UNT of any age regard differing worldviews as in any way correct. but the younger ones find them interesting and often useful in manipulating other races. Yuan-T tend to be more fatalistic about death than humans are. They recognize that all living things die, and that death can come swiftly despite safeguards and scheming. Finite lifespans, however, are no excuse for undue haste or abandonment of the sacred way of Seth. Dying in battle is always honorable, but a long life is also admired, provided that much has been accomplished during that time. To say that a Yuan-T has lived an empty or worthless life is a grave insult. Self-improvement. Most Yuan-T consider the variances among the sub-races, from near human to almost holy serpent, to be part of Seth's divine plan. Yuan-T who embrace this philosophy believe that each individual should make the most of the particular form he was given, striving only to improve his magic, his wisdom, and his own creations, lesser creatures he has bred or augmented. To meddle with his own body is a sinful act, since it is already perfect for its purpose. Other Yuan-T seek to augment or alter themselves directly with crafts and powerful spells. They view such immediate betterment as their deity's true plan for their race, and view Yuan-T who shun such practices as lazy, unworthy cattle that deserve to be dominated and defeated by their wiser and more powerful fellows. Debates on such matters have raged for centuries and show no signs of abating, since the opposing views are tied to deep religious divisions in this essentially devout race. But as the influence of the Yuan-T widens, so too do their views. Over time, they have become more and more like the divided, self-interested, infinitely adaptable humans they so despise. Yuan-T Society. Yuan-T call themselves Ra'el Olo, favored ones. This phrase is usually shortened in daily use to Ra'el and can be modified to Avra'el, friendly or known Yuan-T, and Duthra'el, unfriendly or unfamiliar Yuan-T. Social hierarchy. In general, the more snake-like features a Yuan-T possesses, the higher its status in Ra'el Olo society. Abominations have the highest status, followed by half-bloods, and finally pure-bloods. Mage slayers and holy guardians invariably hold high positions in Yuan-T society, ranking either above or below abominations, depending on the proximity of temples and the perceived local threat of magically empowered, scaleless ones. Within their sub-races, Yuan-T are ranked by achievements and the demonstrated favor of Seth. Individual Yuan-T can sometimes increase their social status by acquiring more serpentine features through grafts, see the appendix, and other magical means. But such an advance in status also requires moving to another geographical area, forsaking kin and tribe, and adapting a new name and a new identity. Such an altered Yuan-T typically does not gain as much status as a native member of the desired subrace would have, because the Death Ra'el in the new location invariably regard her as a stranger, most probably a spy for a rival tribe. Coupled with the loss of familial support and known contacts and sources, this natural mistrust ensures that most Yuan-T avoid such drastic moves. Purebloods are the exception to this rule, since they flourish best when hiding in plain view, among humans in human cities. They often move about to follow trade and pursue opportunities just as humans do. Thus, they are the least likely to be closely tied to a tribe, and the most likely to seek grafts and other serpentine augmentations to increase their status. They typically choose snake-like features that can be hidden from humans under clothing, but quickly revealed in moments of threat or crisis. Relationships. Even though Yuan-T need not love or even like their mates, they are capable of forming strong, though never quite trusting, relationships with others of their kind. The usual Yuan-T term of endearment, which translates into human vocabulary as a fondly spoken dear or dear one, is
ceases.
This address is reserved for Yuan-Ti's intimates, other Vrael Olo to whom she feels especially close. Her family bloodkin are her Ahas. The individuals she dwells and works with compose her Sirath, lesser tribe, and the members of her greater tribe are her Hasarmas. Life cycle. Yuan-Ti hatch from eggs in chambers monitored by bodyguards. The hatchlings are always curious and eager to explore. They seek food immediately and may eat each other if sustenance is not at hand. Their initial training is provided by brood guards that watch over the hatcheries. Vrael Olo are trained in the use of their powers almost from hatching. When the young Yuan-Ti see danger or hear a warning, they turn into tiny vipers and slither under the nearest cover. In the prime of their lives, Yuan-Ti scheme, breed, and work on behalf of their tribes, breeding with the right mates throughout life so as to produce even greater Yuan-Ti. Is a holy act for Vrael Olo, especially those who believe in the perfection of their own forms. Two prospective partners coldly measure one another's abilities and fitness for furthering the race, and if both agree that the match is promising, they usually mate, even if they personally dislike each other. After mating, Yuan-Ti females lay their eggs in brood chambers, marking each clutch with its parentage, then abandon them to the care of the bodyguards. Many Yuan-Ti grow lazy when they reach great age, sleeping or lying in torpor for longer and longer periods, first for days, then weeks, then seasons at a time, and finally years upon years. At last, they fail to wake at all, and their bodies rot, and then mummify where they lie coiled. Some aging elders grow irritable and bite anyone who awakens or disturbs them. A very few choose to go on a last great adventure, feebly seeking some thrill guaranteed to slay them. Most, however, seek to die in peace and luxury, preferably in walled country estates that they have purchased or seized, waited upon by deferential human slaves. Elderly Yuan-Ti are respected for their wisdom, and they aren't spurned or savaged by their more vigorous, younger fellows, even after sinking into slumberous dotage. Organization. The Yuan-Ti of Faerun are divided into seven great tribes called houses, and one intertribal, not-so-secret society. The allegiance of any particular Yuan-Ti is based primarily on blood ties, but can be modified by deliberate choice. Charismatic local leaders like to gather their own Sirath. Most such lesser tribes consist primarily of outcasts from other tribes and individuals who are in disfavor with nearby families. Members of such a group rarely move from one house to another, but they may drop out of contact with their home tribes to operate independently. And occasionally they join with other Sirath to form new tribes. Over the centuries, various greater tribes have risen and fallen. At the present time, seven Yuan-Ti houses flourish in Faerun, along with a society called the Coiled Cabal. This organization is quite different in both nature and origin from the greater tribes, but it functions almost like one of them. House Esselmas. Members of this house, known as Esselmai, are known for their jungle stealth and battle prowess. Those who hunt regularly possess the prehensile tail feet and are accomplished at wielding and hurling weapons with their tails. Such hunters always carry extra weapons with them for this purpose. At present, nine Esselmai secretly rule Lushpool, forming the majority of its 16 satraps. Though the number of Lushpan satraps has grown from the original seven mentioned in the ballad called Seven Satraps, these rulers still remain masked and cloistered. The satraps keep to their luxurious fortress-style compounds known as Asharlans, issuing written decrees through their human servants, who are often tainted ones. When they wish to address the populace, They summon Lashpan citizens to audiences and use spells to speak through the mouths of chained slave women. Most other Aselma dwell along the shores of the Lapal Sea and throughout the northeasternmost Mahar jungles. Their settlements form an unseen serpent that links the Lapal Sea with Lush Pool via a twisting route that avoids the holdings of House Sesehen, their sworn enemy, as much as possible. The enmity between House Aselmas and House Sesehen stems primarily from rival claims to certain key jungle areas. More than one Aselmas beast hunt in the jungles has turned out to be a thinly disguised war party seeking Sesehen and vice versa. House Aselmas is allied with a Genestas tribe, and the two houses have often fought together in the Black Jungles against House Sesehen. The Coiled Cabal also takes care to remain on good terms with Aselma, since the port of Lushpool provides ready access to the Salt, and through it to merchant shippers who can easily reach much of Western Faerun. House Exterminos. House Exterminos is an offshoot of House Sesehen, but the two tribes have remained close allies. The split occurred when two strong claimants for leadership of House Sesehen could not agree on who shall prevail. Instead of instigating the kind of bloodbath that so often marks such disputes, the two claimants agreed to draw apart and allow the other Sesehen to rally around whichever leader they wished. The claimant who garnered the most support would gain mastery of House Sesehen, and the other would lead his followers elsewhere in Faerun to form a new tribe. The offshoot tribe ventured northeast in a long and dangerous journey to seek out new hunting grounds, eventually settling in the Ankh Wood and the Chondal Wood, but attacks from myriad foes weakened the tribe in both areas, and the survivors ultimately gathered and reformed their house in the Osran Mountains. Shortly thereafter, members of the nearby human noble House Exterminos of Londeth stumbled on rituals of Rai and began to summon Yuan-Ti to their aid. So many human Yuan-Ti matings stemmed from this practice that Yuan-Ti blood now dominates the combined clan, whose members are called Exterminar. House Exterminos now rules Londeth, and its members have erected a fine temple to Vry, which is called the Cathedral of Emerald Scales. Other Exterminar can be found all across Faerun, dwelling in hiding beneath human cities. Exterminar act as trade agents for the Sesehen, controlling local smuggling, slaving, and drug trading through the thieves' guilds and adventuring bands that they control, as well as other human agents. Almost all members of this house conduct personal experiments on captured creatures, employing spells, drugs, grafts, and various training processes to create loyal servants and guardians. The elders of the tribe approve of all such activities, so long as such experimentation does not expose House Exterminos to wider public scrutiny in a particular human city, and any useful advancements are shared with the tribe. Thus, should any experiment produce a creature that could be of significant use, such as an aerial steed or a swiftly breedable soldier, the Exterminar could quickly assemble numerous specimens to improve the tribe's chances of attaining true greatness. Many Exterminar choose to augment themselves with a serpent arms graft, thereby gaining extra appendages of astonishing length, up to 30 feet. They usually keep these arms coiled around their necks and shoulders underneath their robes to impart an impression of great size and girth. Senior members of House Exterminos usually possess the graft Yuan-Ti flesh feet. House Hestafi. The Hestafin, as members of this house are known, were plucked from the northeastern shores of the Lapal Sea and magically transported to the ruins of Sarathisan in the year of the Netted Dreams, -320 DR. Since then, they have been part of the ruling nobility of Najara, the Kingdom of Snakes, where they serve primarily as administrators, merchants, and religious leaders. During the reign of Terpenzi, the Hasafin civilized the Ophidian tribes and rebuilt the ruined Saruk city of Cisthirigasun, along with its main temple complex. After the fall of Najara, members of this tribe were instrumental in re-establishing the rule of the Nagara, dark Naga descendants of Terpenzi, then discreetly transforming the Kingdom of Snakes into a major power of the Western Heartlands. House Hasafi also originated the process by which Tainted Ones and Brood Guards are created, but these techniques have now spread to the Yuan-Ti of Llondath and Chultun Peninsula as well. The Hasafin see their Harmas as the most capable and practical of all. They are not too proud to work with and even serve under Nagas, or any other creature for that matter, if doing so ultimately advanced the designs of the Holy Seth and the rightful dominance of the Yuan-Ti race. Other Vra'el Olo, however, see them as unprincipled schemers who shouldn't be trusted with a single copper coin, let alone the future of the race. The Safin are known for their cobra-like hoods. Snake-headed members of this tribe usually possess the cobra head feet. House Genestas. Sometimes derided by other Yuan-Ti as backward Vra'el and half-witted wild ones, members of this house are allied with the Esselmas tribe against House Sessehen for control of large areas of the Black Jungles. The Genesta, as members of House Genestas are called, dwell in many small tunnel holds within the Black Jungles, strongest in numbers along the River Chun and in ruins of Sasahilsmas. They hold sway from Dosal Gap to the River Lapar, and rule openly in the human city of Marhitel, the City of Renegades, which welcomes pirates, slavers, and merchants on the run from less than honest dealings elsewhere, serves as a convenient port from which to trade with the wider world. The High Lord of Mahartiel is Istafis Nsaran, who married the widow of Lord Romister. Nsaran, the deceased Romister, and all the lords and ladies of the ruling Romister family are actually junior pureblood Genesta, though any of them can easily pass for a human when suitably garbed. Every Marhatin knows that Romisters have the blood of the jungle in their veins and can speak with serpents. Citizens often whisper with each other about the Romisters. "They're coming to get us," neighbors confide. "And if you go with them and they bite you in their bedchambers, you grow scales and become their slave, winding up on your belly as a dumb wriggling snake." Whatever truth such tales may have, the Romisters rule fairly. Marhatil remains wealthy, and patrols of human-sized serpents protect the city from jungle beasts and land attacks. Such Genesta patrols can be encountered on the eastern slopes of the Guth Mountains and at the eastern end of the Dolsal Gap. The Genesta's tribe is the least interested of the Yuan-Ti houses in expanding its influence into human cities and civilized lands. Its members view the close contact that other Yuan-Ti seek with humanity as decadent, deliberate tainting of the race and direct manipulation of the Scaleless Ones as a weak-headed and wrong strategy. They maintain that their fellow Yuan-Ti have strayed from their rightful goal of world dominance and are thus doomed to inevitable failure. The elders of House Genestas believe that Yuan-Ti domination can be achieved only by reversing the process of civilization in humanoid lands and reclaiming the wilderness. Their tactics involve extending the jungles, shattering the agricultural base of the cities, and allowing wild beasts to roam everywhere, with Yuan-Ti as their shepherds and masters. The Genesta use servitor beasts to break down walls, shatter bridges, and fell trees across roads, and they regularly sow jungle plants in farm fields. The Genesta refer to such projects as fanging the edges of what humans and other so-called civilized cattle claim as their own. Because of this attitude, only the lowest-ranking purebloods dwell in Marhatil, where the continued presence and rule of House Genestas is tolerated by the majority of tribal elders, only as an experiment in long-term human breeding. Other elders, however, see retaining Mar-Hatil as crucial to the survival of the tribe. After all, if the Genesta retreat entirely into the jungles, House Sesehen can bar them from any contact with outsiders and slowly destroy them. The elders agree on only one issue. Troublemakers in Mar-Hatil must be removed swiftly. Such individuals are either devoured by senior Genesta as a delicacy or snatched away to Sesithinas to serve as subjects for breeding experiments. The Genesta are also interested in capturing jungle beasts and rearing them in captivity, both for food and as experimental subjects. Their ancestors once bred and altered apes in search of a new serpent race, thereby seeding the jungle around Sesithinas with many formidable ape-like creatures that exhibited unusual powers. In the same way, the boldest Genesta now experiment on halflings abducted from Loreen via a portal linking the southern Blank Jungles to the southern Luri Wood, and on humans abducted from surrounding lands. The Genesta are known for their stealth and patience in battle. Warrior members of this tribe usually possess the chameleon hide feet, and most of them can remain motionless for hours, observing their surroundings through slitted eyes and clearly remembering minute details of what they have seen. House Sauringar. The Sauringar tribe once dominated the Sun Ranch Basin, but its members were driven from their ancestral holdings in the Year of Many Serpents, 605 DR, following the alliance of the local human populace with a powerful Nimbural lord. Presently, the tribe remains a strong presence in the Chultan Gar and small one in Samurlog. Its members also control scattered holdings in northern Chult and northern Kalimshan, which are tended by human cultists of Vrai. The Sauringans are also the secret rulers of the independent city-state of Narumbel. The Sauringans are closely allied with Sesehen tribe and the spirit Nagas of Chultan Gar. In addition, they have been working indirectly with the Randine merchant consortium of the Tal Shar for centuries, supporting the Randine's protection policies through targeted acts of piracy. For decades, the Sauringans have subtly guided the Randine away from selecting leaders who exhibit the rampant ophidophobia common to most Tal Shutans. This careful strategy has resulted in a new forged alliance between the Sesehen tribe and the Randine, which has brought security to the far weaker Sauringans. Members of the Sauringar tribe are known for their ability to expand the size of their bodies. Most Sauringans with serpentine torsos possess the puffed torso feet. House Sesehen. The Sesehen tribe is currently the largest and most powerful in the Black Jungles. After House Hastafi vanished in the Year of the Netted Dreams, minus 320 DR, the Sesehen seized the fallen tribe's lands, and with them control of Sesenitharai and the Pit of Vipers. The Sesehen closely allied themselves with Seth in his drive to establish the Serpentine Empire, and they were given control of the Tal Shar Basin as a reward for their efforts. In the Year of Fallen Fury, 20 DR, a decade after the disappearance of Seth, the Sesehen were forced to withdraw from Tal Shar to their holdings on the northwest shore of the Lapal Sea. As a result of this defeat, they sank into centuries of somnolence. Seth's brief reappearance during the Time of Troubles has invigorated the Sesehen, prompting them to forge an insidious alliance with the Rondine Trade Consortium of the Tal Shar. The Sesehen exchange exotic spices and poisons for slaves and a means to transport their spies to ports in the north. The spies, assassins, and thieves of the Sesehen, including members of House Extaminos, are scattered throughout Faerun, where they work to advance Yuan-Ti plans for domination of the surface world. The Sesehen count the Exterminos and Sarigar tribes as their closest allies, but they clash frequently with a coiled cabal, since both groups see themselves as the rightful crafters of UNT dominance in Faerun. The Sesehen openly fight the Anselmas and Genestas tribes even more frequently, since all those houses claim sections of the Black Jungles. Members of the Sesehen tribe experiment extensively on other creatures of the Black Jungles. Their most successful creations are the serpent-like Tikhwana, and the house is now served by the predatory Tikhana Deinikiasis. Sesehen are known for their ability to spit venom. Most of the snake-headed members of this tribe possess the spit venom feat. House Serades. The Serades once openly ruled the Thindol Basin, but the defeat of their lizard folk slave soldiers by troops of the Shun Imperium in the Year of Hounds, 293 DR, forced them to retreat to their undersea holdings. For some time thereafter, members of House Serades ruled indirectly through agents who infiltrated the courts of Thindol. This strategy collapsed in the Year of Many Serpents, 605 DR, when the agents of the Serades were unmasked and forced to concede defeat yet again. The Serades currently dominate the waterways of Thindol and the subterranean passage known as Lambret's Folly. These holdings are isolated enough that the tribe counts no other UNT tribe as a true ally or foe. Ever since they lost control of Thindol, the Serades have been attempting to reassert their influence over the humans of that realm. But the wary vigilance of the rampant Ophidiophobes who dwell there has made progress difficult at best. The tribe has found much greater success in conquering the Kuatua tribes of Kothgulakpu, see Lambrand's Folly in Chapter 7, and employing them to rule the watery depths. The Serades employ Kuatoa as farmers of the sea to harvest fish, pearls, and certain seaweeds that are valuable to human alchemists and scent makers. These marine products are sold through agents or used for bribes in Thindol. Certain Serades are growing impatient with the slow process of achieving real power there, however, so they are looking to hire and ultimately control some outlander adventurers who can add muscle to their intrigues ashore. Members of this tribe are known for their ability to breathe and swim underwater. Most snake-necked Serades possess the water adaptation feat, sea feats in races of Faerun. The Coiled Cabal. This secret society of arcane spellcasters is dominated by the Hestafin, but it draws members from all the great houses of the UNT. Though the Vra'el Olo do not consider it an independent tribe in its own right, it is often treated like one in intertribal politics, especially since membership requires that loyalty to the society take precedence over tribal allegiances. The mark of the Coiled Cabal is an S-shaped serpent with open-jawed heads at both ends. The Coiled Cabal has power bases in the Great Petrified Serpent, Serpent Hills, Skolonroa, Forest of Worms, Semerov's Tower, Hlondeth, and ruins of Lesper, Shar, and at various ruins and settlements currently under construction in the Black Jungles. The society is allied with the Anselmas, Exterminos, and Hesafi tribes, but it often marches to its own drum. Members of the Coiled Cabal clash most frequently with the Sesehen tribe, because both groups see themselves as the rightful leaders in the push for open dominance of Faerun. Cabal members work in Omkathus, small groups of a dozen or so individuals that independently undertake missions. In times of open strife, such missions are often handed down by superiors known as Overhoods. At other times, however, each Omkathus devises its own missions and submits its plans to an Overhood for approval. An Omkathus may report to more than one Overhood, but usually no more than three. A Cabal member who personally knows more than three Overhoods is likely to draw missions with a high likelihood of death in the field. Overhoods in turn report to greater overhoods. The upper hierarchy of the Cabal is largely hidden and free of formal titles or rules, but it culminates in a council of seven leaders known informally as the Hooded Ones, and more properly as the Urcoil. These Yuan-Ti direct the Cabal in accordance with their own mysterious and complex plan. Its specifics and secrets are never shared, but thoughtful members who observe Cabal activities over time often conclude that the Hooded One's strategies have much to do with covert domination of certain individual humans. Many seem designed to subvert local rulers and arcane spellcasters of all kinds. Others are obviously geared to shift the attitude of all humans against temples and priesthoods, probably to weaken clerical influence over the human societies of Faerun. Some Yuan-Ti believe that the Coil Cabal wants to shatter the power of Seth's clergy, reducing his priests to little more than entertainers who provide comforting rituals for the Vra'el Olo. Whether or not the Cabal is pursuing such a goal, and whether that goal is a good or bad one, are matters of hot and frequent debate among Vra'el Olo. Some Yuan-Ti feel that Seth's priests have already lost power over the populace, since increasing numbers of Yuan-Ti see their personal faith in Seth as something that can be separated from obedience to clerics of the god. Although the Hooded Ones do seem to have particular ends in mind, the Cabal is by no means a monolithic organization that unerringly pursues a single, coherent goal. Side intrigues flourish, and many seemingly unrelated projects are underway at any given time. Some Cabal overhoods, for example, direct their underlings to slay and frustrate members of the Red Wizards of Thay and the Cult of the Dragon at every opportunity. Others believe that those same organizations should be aided, strengthened, infiltrated, and conquered from within. In this way, they can become great new dark arms with which the Yuan-Ti can tame the teeming hordes of humanity. The Coiled Cabal embraces a variety of behaviors as well as viewpoints. Some Umkuths function very well like human adventuring bands, while others more closely resemble secretive tower-cloistered wizards conducting magical research. Many Cabal members pursue small plots to enrich themselves, apparently with the tacit approval of their superiors. An exchange of threats often determines who holds superior rank when Cabal members meet, but imposters pretending to hold overhood or greater overhood rank are rare, thanks to various scrying and divination spells. Households. Yuan-Ti live in ordered hierarchical groups known as households, each of which is governed by a strict chain of command. The members of a household are related by either blood or mating. Any Yuan-Ti who breaks the chain of command, either by defying orders or by reporting to a superior other than the one directly above him, is regarded with suspicion and distaste. Such a transgression is usually accompanied by a formal loss of status that results in a lower position on the chain of command. Such a demotion may not occur if senior Yuan-Ti dispute with each other over the issue at hand, and a majority of their kin don't strongly side with either one of them. Persistent breakers of the hierarchy, however, are cast out or even slain in accidents that everyone in the households knows were not accidents at all. Young and ignorant Yuan-Ti are permitted a few transgressions against authority, but they are sharply reprimanded and punished by curbs on their behavior for such indiscretions. Heirs, lovers, and other favored Yuan-Ti who defy their elders are typically punished with dangerous missions. Those who return are entirely forgiven until the next time they defy authority. For non-Yuan-Ti, breaking the chain of command means death, though its manner depends on the status of the individual. A slave, valued for diligent long-term service, becomes a sacrifice to the gods. One in disfavor usually becomes food after being punished, and then slain by other slaves. A captor or a slave of marginal status is often hunted for sport and casually maimed, then sent to the stew pots or simply devoured alive. Most Yuan-Ti consider it good form to anticipate what orders an elder plans to issue, and to read small clues of manner, tone of voice, and attitude so as to react accordingly before an order is given. But only the most deranged priests of Seth, and then only those in the temple hierarchy, expect other Yuan-Ti to know what's expected of them without being told, or try to punish those who don't manage to read their minds. Orders are always given politely and quietly. An eye blink, tail tap, or nod indicates that an order has been heard. If no such signal is forthcoming after a few moments, the order is repeated just as politely, but often slightly more loudly, and usually from closer range. Eye contact is established in conjunction with a repeated order if possible. Pointed refusal to acknowledge orders is normally dared only by elders and Yuan-Ti who believe themselves of equal or superior rank to the issuer of the order. A Yuan-Ti may also be temporarily exempt from authority by virtue of cult membership, orders from another, higher superior, or status as the emissary of a temple or tribe. Elders. Fra'el Olo households differ in how they treat ailing elders. Such family members are rarely attacked or slain, primarily because doing so would establish a precedent for similar mistreatment of the perpetrators in their dotage. Most Yuan-Ti households ensure that such elders are properly fed and housed, and otherwise simply ignore them, especially if they have shown a tendency to bite when disturbed. A few entrust them with certain family secrets, so as to keep ambitious young family members in check. Yuan-Ti who need the favor of these failing elders to access family magic items or simply wealth tend to become more cooperative, resourceful, and respectful than those who do not. As an added benefit, Vrael Olo who have cared properly for an ailing elder can ensure the support of bloodkin outside the household in future disputes, whether that elder still lives or not. Some Yuan-Ti plan for retirement well in advance, purchasing luxurious walled country estates in which they can live out their final years. When they sense their faculties beginning to fail, they relinquish their status within the household and take up residence in their own palatial manors, where they can rule supreme over deferential human slaves and die slowly and peacefully. Elders who refuse to give up their positions to those more able, or who otherwise defy the authority of the Srath, are often seen as irritants. Rather than slaying them, however, their families often buy them out, settling them in comfortable retirement elsewhere. Families choosing this route usually either purchase or seize a human dwelling of appropriate luxury. Almost all Yuan-Ti respect the property and person of a Yuan-Ti elder living in retirement, regardless of tribe or politics. Invading an elder's walled compound, stealing his property or committing violence against his person, or slaves, is simply not done. Dozens of such palatial mansions, particularly in the wilder eastern fringes of Kalimshan and the southern backlands of the Tal Shar, house frightened human slaves who try to ignore the withered corpse of a dead Yuan-Ti master in their midst, or live their lives around the coiled, immobile form of an elder who has been asleep for decades. Funeral customs. Ra'el Olo funeral rites may vary from tribe to tribe, Srath to Srath, and temple to temple. Some Yuan-Ti burn or just abandon corpses, but many try to glean scales or skins from the dead before leaving the remains to decay in an open or burying them under small stone cairns. A few favor feeding the dead to certain local monsters, which are thereafter treated as oracles of sort, because they have swallowed the memories of the deceased. Yuan-Ti wishing to divine the future, simply observe the creature's behavior and interpret it according to certain little-known guidelines. The bodies of tribal elders or leaders are usually treated with more reverence than those of lesser members of the tribe, and Yuan-Ti priests are almost always ritually burned on the altars of their deities. The Exterminos, Soringar, and Sesehen tribes employ a ritual known as To the Egg Return. First, they wash and arrange their dead in as intact a manner as possible, even sewing on or magically reattaching several body parts. Once so prepared, corpses are bound in clean linen and shrouded in windings, pieces of cloth that have been tied together into long continuous strips and treated with resins. The end results are oval balls that resemble the eggs from which the dead Yuan Ti once hatched. These eggs are then walled up in secret caves to mummify. Such caverns are open only to add more dead, or for adornment with tribal relics or trophies. Dwellings. Brile Olo can adapt to many environments. In most cases, they utilize whatever is readily available in their target area to build homes. Jungle. Jungle-dwelling Yuan Ti often take control of overgrown stone ruins left behind by other races. If no such option is available, they construct abodes in trees or tunnels. Yuan Ti tree homes are usually gigantic trees that stand isolated in swamps. Interior spiral wiggle tunnels link each tree with underground passages, and perhaps even other trees. Extensive tunnel systems in the jungle can quickly become choked by fast-growing roots, and all manner of creatures can invade them, thus retaining control and ensuring free passage. Through such tunnels is a constant battle that often costs many slave lives. Hills. Yuan Ti hill homes are natural or artificial mounds riddled with dwelling dens and encircled by concentric walls. In the center are the actual living spaces, subsequent rings, enclosed storage areas, lookout and spellcasting towers, livestock, and finally a maze ring studded with traps through which only two torturous but safe routes exist. The outermost ring beyond the maze is where guardian beasts, experimentally altered jungle monsters of all sorts, roam. These creatures are kept hungry and are thus eager to attack any non-Yuan Ti, or anyone else they're ordered to devour. Other terrain. Most Yuan Ti that inhabit the more civilized areas of Faerun prefer to live in subterranean crawl tunnels, or in structures built of stone. In cold regions, such dwellings always extend below frost level to where the temperature remains fairly constant. If volcanic activity or other subterranean sources of warmth are present, Yuan Ti tunnels always encircle such features. Lair features. Yuan Ti prefer the walls of their dwellings to be smooth and free of certain molds and fungi. Beyond that, they are not especially picky. They don't mind the presence of vapors, the litter that accumulates in ruins, or minor incursions by other creatures, such as edible birds and small furry forest dwellers. If possible, narrow crawl tunnels are built into each Yuan Ti lair to slow or stop large invaders. Sunning ledges and other warmed places are provided so that Vrile Olo and other reptilian inhabitants can steadily access a comfortable range of temperatures. Most Yuan Ti dwellings contain at least one Sarmath, or prayer focused to Seth. Such a feature may be as simple as a snake-headed spiral scratched on a wall, or as elaborate as a life-sized hand-carved stone snake balancing upright on its tail. A statue of this sort invariably features back and forth loops of coils, similar to those of a caduceus. It stands in a smooth carved bowl that can be filled with flammable scented oil and the bodies of sacrifices. Yuan Ti that build anew or have sufficient resources, time and slaves, to reshape the ruins they inhabit often create sloping walls that are fairly smooth and pierced by many slither holes, linking chamber to chamber. Broken rock and rubble are cleared away, and foliage that blocks the sun from shining directly on at least one area of the ruin is cut back. Horizontal tree trunks or stoned pillars are installed in large chambers to serve as resting perches and high refuges against intruders. Yuan Ti who make use of Osra oil, see Osra in Chapter 10, usually also pierce walls, ceilings, and floors with vent tunnels that allow the smoke to drift from a burning chamber into the areas of a dwelling. Dwelling decor. In Yuan-ti dwellings, mosaics dominated by sinuous curves are common, and silken translucent tapestries are favored by many. The chambers of the wealthy tend to be dominated by trophies and slither rubs, decorative sculptures with sharp edges situated to allow a chipped or dangling scale to be rubbed off with ease. Slither glows are especially popular with Yuan-ti of high social status. These liquid, ever-shifting paintings consist of flat glass vessels filled with many hued oils that swirl when heated from below by small oil lamp flames. A wall-mounted slither glow may be painted with a lone serpent eye on one side, which is revealed at random times by the shifting swirls of oil. Ra'el Olo often cut shallow pools into the floors of their dwellings, or fashion great bowls with slither ramps ascending both their inner and outer surfaces. Such vessels are often filled with scented oils that the Yuan-ti can glide through or bask in to banish the stink of human contact, to keep their scales from drying or becoming brittle, or simply for the sensual pleasure of remaining fully supple. Many Yuan-ti like to dream deep thoughts for hours whilst thus soaking, sometimes enshrouded in thick clouds of pungent Osara smoke. Yuan-ti purebloods are suitable as player characters, as are the Yuan-ti creations known as Tainted Ones, and in some cases, Brood Guards. See the racial traits table in the appendix. Purebloods. Pureblood travel throughout Faerun, infiltrating human societies everywhere. Most can easily disguise their snake-like features to pass for humans. Typically, purebloods serve as spies and agents, carrying out the plots of higher-ranking Yuan-ti. Some, however, are ambitious enough to make their own plans, and a few even leave their fellow Yuan-ti and embrace human society completely. Such purebloods can make enjoyable player characters. Tainted Ones and Brood Guards. Tainted Ones are Yuan-ti servitors created from humans who drink a distillation of Yuan-ti venom, mixed with certain roots and herbs. The recipe for this mixture is a closely guarded secret that, despite much energetic spying, hasn't yet spread to every tribe of the Vrael Olo. A human who drinks the mixture, willingly or not, must make a DC 16 fortitude saving throw. Success means an immediate lapse into a coma, followed by death 1 hour later. Failure leaves the imbiber sickened and requires an immediate DC 15 constitution check. Success on this check begins a painful and permanent change into a tainted one during the next 1d6 days. Failure means a groggy, torpid transformation into a brood guard over a period of 1d6 plus 6 days. Onrushing death from a failed fortitude save isn't necessary an escape from Yuan-ti servitude. During the hour in which such a creature lies comatose, it can be revived with a delay poison or neutralized poison effect. Yuan-ti half-bloods and abominations often use their neutralized poison ability to revive a victim, so they can administer the mixture again, necessitating a new fortitude save. They repeat the attempt as often as necessary until they gain a servitor rather than a human corpse. Humans can be rescued from either transformation by at least two magical methods: casting neutralized poison, dispel magic, remove curse, and heal on the victim in that order. Reverses the transformation in half a day, but the rescued human permanently loses 1 point of intelligence in the process. Alternatively, a properly worded wish, limited wish, or miracle spell can undo the change instantly with no loss of intelligence. Once the transformation is complete, only a wish or miracle spell can restore a tainted one or brood guard to its former human state. Only humans can be successfully transformed with a mixture. Any other humanoid that drinks it must make the same D16 fortitude saving throw. But success leaves the imbiber sickened for 1d4 rounds, and failure results in a coma followed by death in 1d4 plus 1 rounds. Brood guards. Brood guards begin their service to the Yuan-T as low-ranked slaves. Naked and unarmed except for their claws and teeth, they stand guard in and around the brood chambers. Brood guards eat and sleep at their posts, never leaving the vicinity of the brood chambers except to move eggs and hatchlings under Yuan-T supervision when the community is threatened. See the brood guards entry in Monsters of Faerun for more information. Tainted ones. Though tainted ones serve primarily as spies and agents in human cities, they are also frequently employed as bodyguards and stealthy strike forces by pure-blood Yuan-T working in human settlements. Tainted ones who outlive their Yuan-T masters often become free agents in the shadowy underworlds of human cities, where they formerly served. A few even betray their masters, pitting the agents of one Yuan-T tribe against another, or arranging for humans to catch and destroy their vile Olo masters. A few masterless tainted ones make their livings as slavers, poison dealers, and fences for Yuan-T of many tribes seeking to do business in a given city. Such businesses are lucrative, and rumor has it that at least one tainted one amassed sufficient wealth to purchase his own escape back into true humanity by hiring a good aligned archmage to cast a wish spell upon him. Magic of the Yuan-T. Yuan-T are masters of experimentation, both magical and otherwise. The Vrile Olo have had centuries to reap the benefits of Saruk society in research of thousands of inspired Nagas and Yuan-T ancestors. Thus, the depth and variety of arcane spells at their command rival those of the most magically mighty human cultures. Through their own research, the Yuan-T have developed subtle variants of many human-created spells that paralyze creatures or move them from afar. A few anathemas can also use ability rip and trait removal. See Chapter 11. Yuan-T are always developing new spells and new variants of established Dwemers. Thus, an encounter with Yuan-T spellcasters, especially Coil Cabal members, presents a situation of unpredictable danger. Many spells widely known among Yuan-T are described in Chapter 11. These include Fang Trap, Razor Scales, Serpent Arrow, Venom Bolt, and Whirl of Fangs, deities of the Yuan-T. At the time the Yuan-T were created, the Saruk empires were monotheistic societies. They worshipped the World Serpent. All other gods were viewed as inferior blasphemies, and the Saruk believed that those who worshipped them should either be turned to the veneration of the Great Scale One or destroyed. After the Miharishuk Empire fell, many Yuan-T sought different fragments of the World Serpent to lead them to the truth, hoping to leave behind the dark decadence of their former masters. Most of these gods were forgotten long ago, but the worship of Seth took root and became the foundation of modern-day Yuan-T religion. Today, the majority of Yuan-T worship Seth with a strength and fervor that astonishes other beings. Some Yuan-T, however, still search for other gods to follow, usually because their own self-importance demands that they become the most favored mortal devotees of their divine patrons. And doing so is easier when there are few other worshippers with whom to compete. In particular, the worship of the elder gods Miharshulk, Sernes, and Varai still thrives in certain areas. Varai is secretly worshipped by many pure-blood Yuan-T who dwell in and under human cities and have come to prefer the bustle and color of such settings to their own realms. Miharshulk is often venerated by outcast or wandering Yuan-T, particularly those who restlessly travel Faerun's wild places and glory in hunting dangerous beasts. Some such Yuan-T believe that by worshipping Miharshulk, they are shedding the decadence of their own culture by bypassing the inevitable failure of following the ways of Seth. Many UNT cults form around anathemas. Some of these creatures claim to be awakened older gods. Others proclaim themselves entirely new deities. At present, this later category includes Belis Rai, Olom, Felris, Servan, and Seranth, whose worshippers have clashed openly with other UNT and occasionally raided human caravans. Such pretenders to divinity doubtless exist, but have thus far managed to remain hidden. Seth the Slitherer Supreme. For most UNT, there is Seth and only Seth. The other serpentine deities that some Vryl Olo have worshipped over the years have all been either masks worn by Seth or false faces of the fell deities venerated by scaleless ones. These latter beings seek always to subvert UNT from the truth of Seth and lead them into decadent indolence, loss of power, and ultimate betrayal and destruction. Seth whispers in dreams, speaks directly through his priests, and on rare occasions even appears to his faithful. More often, however, the Slitherer Supreme leaves signs in the smoke of his temples after suitable sacrifices of life have been made on his altars. Seth guides in mysterious ways, leading his faithful toward ever greater power and eventual supremacy over the world. The path to dominance that he reveals, however, is invariably a winding, veiled, and subtle one, rather than the destructive and brutal route of conquest embraced by humanoids. The Sacred Way of Seth. Devout worshippers of Seth may express the god's creed in different ways, and indeed many fall to arguing over its specifics. In general, however, they all believe in the following tenets. Seth guards secrets to make his believers strong, imparting hints and aid to faithful followers subtly and sparingly. Those who use the god's gifts to achieve power and success are pleasing to Seth and worthy of rewards ranging from rebirth after death to augmentation with increased powers such as serpentine limbs, stronger venom, or greater mastery of magic. All secrets are known to Seth. He yields them up sparingly in return for a service he finds pleasing, such as achievements that benefit all Vryl Olo, sacrifices made in his name or upon his altars, and obedience to the priests of Seth and orders from the god himself. All UNT must act in accordance with the sacred way of Seth, that is, subtly. Whenever possible, Vryl Olo should choose manipulation over open confrontation, the whisper over the fang, and subterfuge over battle spells. Those who follow the sacred way of Seth know their foes, think ahead, plan forward, and slither well. Sacrifices to Seth. The Slitherer Supreme hears all prayers from his UNT followers, but is likely to dispense actual aid only when the sacrifice of life accompanies the request. Any sort of intelligent creature, that is, one with an intelligence score of 3 or higher, is a suitable sacrifice. Though some creatures are more pleasing to the god than others. Sacrifices rank in desirability according to the list below. A scaled creature that submits willingly to death in Seth's name. Any sort of scaled creature. A scaleless one with arcane spellcasting ability or a natural spell-like power. A scaleless one with great personal power or achievements. Any other sort of scaleless one. In any of these categories, a more formidable creature is always more pleasing to Seth than a small and insignificant one. Thus, an ogre experienced in battle is far more worthy than a halfling infant. Fervor or feeling while conducting a sacrifice is more important to the Slitherer Supreme than the total number or frequency of sacrifices offered. Sacrifices are expected whenever a worshipper needs to atone for straying from the sacred way, but they are entirely optional for worshippers who have been diligently following the wishes of Seth, as communicated personally in dream visions or by his priests. The manner in which the ritual is conducted and the attitude of the victim also have a bearing on the acceptability of the sacrifice. An ideal sacrificial victim is one that submits willingly to death for the glory of Seth. Few scaled ones are truly happy about dying for Seth. But UNT and other scaled ones often see some benefit in giving themselves wholly to the god. Next most prized are victims that participate willingly in preparing themselves for sacrifice, Potential sacrifices are usually offered all they desire of food, drink, treasure, company, and favors. Yuan-ti frequently offer aid in slaying a hated rival or righting a perceived wrong, then slyly drug their intended victim's food or drink so as to render them unable to resist. In the third rank of acceptability are creatures slain in Seth's name on the altar of Seth by a worshipper employing either a melee weapon or her own fangs. Sacrificial victims slain by spells or bound so as to hamper resistance are less desirable. A troused, terrified, struggling victim is the least desirable sacrifice of all. Offering up such a victim requires little effort, almost no risk, and not much subtlety, so it is unlikely to impress the god. The sacrifice is best performed by either biting away some of the victim's throat or face, or biting off an extremity, usually a hand. Either way, death results from blood loss, not from poison or other means. The slayer should slither through the victim's blood while praying aloud to Seth. Specific rewards for sacrifices are given in Chapter 2 of the Book of Vile Darkness. Alternatively, the supplicant may receive cryptic replies to specific questions, either as hissed words in the mind or as visions. Other options for rewards include healing, whole or partial restoration of lost hit points while in contact with a sacrificial altar, ready to cast spells, placed directly in the recipient's mind, or spontaneous on-the-spot alterations of. Form. Purebloods into half-bloods or serpentine features akin to the drafts detailed in Chapter 10. The Answered Prayers of Seth. Almost all priests of Seth are serpent-headed half-bloods, but the most powerful are often multiple-headed Yuan-ti. Seth accepts, ordains, and ranks his priests in dream visions. No Yuan-ti can declare himself a priest of Seth or remain one without the agreement of the Slitherer Supreme. If any Yuan-ti counterfeits priestly status in any place sacred to Seth, the god is instantly aware of it and may inform any true priest on the consecrated ground via visions, telepathy, or other remote communication. The clergy of Seth tend and clean the god's sacred places and prevent defilements and intrusions of non-believers other than sacrifices. His priests also breed, rear, feed, and train the snakes that serve as temple messengers and errant runners, and they manage and dispense all temple catches of poisons, osra oil, and monetary and magical treasures. Furthermore, they are charged with communicating the will of Seth to all Yuan-ti within their reach, and with giving holy orders in times of tribal strife or war with scaleless ones. In addition, they continually monitor Yuan-ti society for signs of disloyalty to Seth and perils to all Vrael Olo. The Deep Truth. For at least an age, Seth has been growing more lethargic, often sleeping for centuries at a time, but continuing to grant spells to his priests in his dreaming. In the time of troubles, Seth appeared over the black jungles as a giant winged magic-using snake and exhorted his priests to gather their strength. Shortly thereafter, while asleep in his lair, Seth was magically bound into a deeper captivity by the deity Set, working through minions such as the Octonian Saruk. Set became Seth, assuming his portfolio and all the aspects it already subsumed, including Varai and Mersharulk. He usurped Seth's place as Lord of the Yuan-ti and the source of their divine magic. To mark his assumption of Seth's portfolios, Set created the creatures known as Were-Serpents, see Chapter 6. All Yuan-ti now receive divine spells from Set, even though they believe they're receiving them from Seth or some other Vrael Olo deity. The majority of Yuan-ti still believe that Varai, Mersharulk, Sisitharas, Set, and Seth are all separate entities, and that Seth reigns supreme. Most either know nothing about the strife of Set and Seth, see the racial history of Saruk in Chapter 5, or don't want to know anything about it. Those who dare to speak directly about the matter insist that Seth is troubled by disloyalty among the Vrael Olo, and it must be rooted out. Beyond that, they leave divine matters to Seth and concentrate on and obeying the priests of Seth and living their lives in accordance with a sacred way. They fervently believe that if enough Yuan-ti focused on those tasks, their troubles would end and Ulvrael Olo would rise to their rightful triumph. In truth, Seth is slumbering fitfully, and portions of his nightmares have been visited upon his followers since the time of troubles. These disturbing and increasingly frequent dreams have convinced most Yuan-Ti and non-Octhonian Saruk that Seth is angered or upset. Many of them have performed repeated divinations to discover what's happening. Through their efforts, they have learned that Seth is distressed and desires them to do something, though what that might be is not clear. This knowledge has prompted a few Yuan-Ti to undertake quests of widely varying sorts, and Vryl Olo priests to order an even greater variety of strange practices. A very few of Seth's followers are aware that the god is in some way losing a battle with another deity, and that the Octhonian Saruk are somehow to blame. Those privy to this knowledge are keeping quiet about it for now, in hopes of learning more about the threat and what they can do about it before they spread the word among the tribes. The Octhonian Saruk know exactly what Seth did, but they have intentionally been misleading the Yuan-Ti and sowing discord among them to delay Vryl Olo investigations and prevent any agreement about what to do. At present, the Yuan-Ti who pray to Seth receive spells from Seth, whose domains are air, darkness, evil, hatred, law, magic, and scaly kind. The real Seth's domains are air, animal, chaos, evil, knowledge, magic, planning, scaly kind, and trickery. If Seth is ever freed, his worshippers will have access to his domains, but not those of Seth. Relations with other races. The Yuan-Ti regard most other races as inferior, but their precise attitude varies according to the degree of serpent nature each race possesses. Saruk. The Yuan-Ti recognize that the now rare Saruk have power over their race by the will of Seth himself. After all, the divine Seth made the Saruk his personal emissaries and servants many eons ago, naming them the Claws of Seth and granting them the ability to create other serpent races. Not only did the Saruk create the Yuan-Ti, but they also have the ability to alter Yuan-Ti bodies at will. Thus the Vryl Olo typically obey, fear, and even fawn over any Saruk they encounter. On the other hand, the Yuan-Ti also remember the Saruk as lazy and decadent beings. Indeed, a few of them were even found unworthy of Seth's favor in the past. Thus, a constant watch must be kept upon them, so that worthy Yuan-Ti cannot lose Seth's favor or endanger their fellows by following foolish or overly selfish Saruk commands. Other reptiles. To a Yuan-Ti, witless reptiles are kin of a sort, though they are obviously lesser creatures that must be made to see their rightful places as inferiors. Thus, the Yuan-Ti are free to exploit, tame, enslave, and use such creatures as desired. Dragonkin, Terrafolk, and the like are a measure better, but they are still regarded as inferiors rather than allies. Most Yuan-Ti respect dragons for their great powers and longevity, and Nagas for the fell magic they control. Shape-changers that have access to reptilian wereforms are obviously touched by Seth, thus they are viewed as mysterious and holy creatures that have a rightful place, even though they are inferior to Yuan-Ti. Lizard folk are stupid but physically powerful, and therefore useful as allies and servants. Scaleless ones. Like the Saruk that created them, Yuan-Ti loathe all non-scaled species, regarding them as inferior beings. Humanoids' completely unscaled bodies are unsettling to the Yuan-Ti. Indeed, some abominations regard human bodies as obscene, and the human-like pure-blood Yuan-Ti as little better. Furthermore, humans in particular have an odor that is offensive to the Yuan-Ti. Hence the custom of applying heavy perfume to the skin in areas controlled by serpent folk. Yuan-Ti regard humanoid attitudes as base and strange, and their overly excited mannerisms grate on the Yuan-Ti's nerves. Humans and their ilk are always busy, and most are completely untrustworthy. The most prudent tactic is to control them through drugs or coercion, or more simply eliminate those that serve no useful purpose. However, many Yuan-Ti who dwell among humans for extended periods of time grow to regard them as fascinating and often surprising beasts that can provide endless entertainment. Some Yuan-Ti even come to admire certain humans and enjoy particular human customs, viands, fashions, and games. Yuan-Ti equipment. Since Yuan-T consider themselves the most perfect of all beings, they use only the best equipment available, typically of at least masterwork quality. After all, the finest creatures deserve the finest tools. Yuan-T encounters. Player characters can encounter a Yuan-T warband on a jungle trail or en route to a major Yuan-T temple with sacrifices in tow. Such a band usually consists of 1d12 plus 1 purebloods, 1d4 plus 1 halfbloods, and 1d3 plus 1 abominations. Small gangs of purebloods undertaking a mission in a human city often consist of as few as 1d3 plus 1 Yuan-T. Ready to use villains and allies. In any Forgotten Realms campaign, adventurers worthy of their reputations must inevitably come to grips with Yuan-T. The two pureblood opponents detailed below might be encountered skulking in the sewers or cellars of a human city. More formidable sample villains appear in Chapter 8. Mruth Lisk. Mruth Lisk was the offspring of Yuan-T who'd been forced to take part in breeding experiments. His parents fled with the rest of their Sarath when strife erupted within their tribe, just which tribe Mrutholsk never knew. For generations, the Sarath moved north, slithering from jungles to forests and moving on whenever they encountered other Yuan-T. Mrutholsk was hatched in the eastern fringes of the High Forest, where strange monsters were many. The casualties among his scaly kin rose precipitously, and he was soon orphaned. The rest of his wrath scattered shortly after, leaving Mruth Lisk on his own. For years he lived wild, hunting the fringes of the forest for food, until he reached a section of its western flank that was not far north of Skomber. There he began to track lone prospectors, small bands of foresters, and other humans who frequented the forest. Night after night he lay still on the forest floor beyond the firelight of encamped humans, listening to their talk of wealth, cut-and-thrust trade, and life in human cities. When his targets fell asleep, he pounced upon them and slew them, taking their goods for his own, but the conversations he heard struck with him, preying on his mind until he began to crave the chance to taste life in the world of humans for himself. The threat of an early cold winter finally drove Mruth Lisk to hunt beyond the forest along the trade roads. There he followed several bands of folk who were hurrying to Silvery Moon, ere snow deep. It became his habit to don the clothes of his earlier victims and fall in with small groups of travelers, sizing them up as prey. One night, the cold drove him to seek fire warmth, with a group consisting of a few armored men and many women bundled up and shivering in heavy furs and hide cloaks. A few moments of conversation revealed that the group was actually a troop of dancers bound for Silvery Moon, and two of their men had already been lost to wolves on the journey. Mruth Lisk offered himself as a replacement and spent that winter in Silvery Moon learning on the job. When spring came, Mruth Lisk accompanied the troop south to Waterdeep, then promptly vanished, heading for the warmer coastal cities of Amn. From there, he began to tour the human settlements of Faerun in disguise, seeking a place where he could make his fortune and settle down. Mruth Lisk loves dancing and views it as a perfect cover, since entertainers can enter human cities at will. But he dreams of becoming a respectable merchant in the right port, a pillar of the community who can host minstrels and dancers at feasts. By day, while running a rich smuggling and slaving operation from his own arbor connected cellars by night. Such an arrangement would allow him to hunt and slay trade rivals, as well as traitors in his own shady organization, thus ridding himself of annoyances while satisfying his own bloodlust. To make this dream real, Mruth Lisk needs money, trade contacts, and the right port. Thus he has taken up adventuring, a lifestyle that he very much enjoys. Mruth Lisk may be encountered alone or in the company of 1d6 human rogues, thugs or dancers. If his companions are dancers, then he is temporarily performing as part of their group to earn food, shelter, and a few coins, while subtly making his own contacts within the area. Rogues or thugs who travel with him are local shady talent with whom he's negotiating or perhaps even disputing. When local criminals want certain individuals to disappear, Mruth Lisk often purchases them, drugs them to make them biddable, and then resells them elsewhere as slaves. If he has such a captive with him, he often claims the person is a sick relative or village elder whom he is escorting to a particular temple to die. Mrathlisk also sells information he's gained elsewhere, sometimes using a peculiarly knotted thong as a memory aid to record numbers and individual letters of script that spells out names. Alternate form. Mrathlisk can psionically assume the form of a tiny to large viper. This ability is similar to a polymorph spell caster level 19, but he does not regain any hit points for changing form, and he can assume only viper forms. He gains the viper's bite attack and poison special attack. Detect Poison. Mrathlisk can use Detect Poison as the spell caster level 6 at will. Hide in plain sight. Mrathlisk can use the hide skill even while being observed as long as he is within 10 feet of any shadow except his own. Description. Mrathlisk looks like a typically young human male with brown hair and dark riveting eyes. His slender, supple body seems appropriate for a dancer, and his fine-featured face leads some people to think he must have elf blood in his ancestry. He takes clips his fingernails regularly since they grow quite rapidly. His tongue is long and forked, so he takes care never to show it. Mrathlisk cosmetically disguises the scales on his lower back to look like burned, scarred, not wholly healed skin. Bandages artistically decorated with disgusting, oozing liquid keep most folk from wiping the disguise aside and discovering the truth. He usually wears his companion's Sriss wound around his body, under his clothing. Tathlas. Born and reared in the cellars of a major port by Yuan-Ti slavers, Tathlas has dwelt in cities all her life, hiding among humans. She earned her coins initially by stealing and later by slaying. Tathlas loves to kill, humans in particular, and since she learned that some humans would pay to have others slain, she's lived quite well. The secret to her success is twofold. Know thy victim before striking, and know thy employer. Well aware that employers sometimes try to silence assassins after their work is done, Tathlas always arranges a safe method of payment, preferably in advance, and a means of escape from the area. Tathlas lives in a world of hiding places, traps, and ready disguises, and she trusts no one, a policy that has prolonged her life more than once. No matter where she is in the city, she's never far from a place where she can hide, even if it's shielded corner of someone else's roof. She equips all of her hiding places with food, weapons, clothes, and disguise aids, such as masks and cosmetics, to ensure that she can survive for days and sleep out unnoticed when the time is right. When the market for murder is slow, Tathlas is happy to make money by means other than killing. Under the name Tatha, she operates a makeup, tattooing, and body painting service in a storefront in the wealthy part of town. She specializes in superb facial makeup and swirling, ornamental body paint designed to distract viewers from body plumpness when skin-revealing gowns are worn. This lucrative business also allows her to peddle scents, drugs, and poisons on the side to a clientele of wealthy but jaded women while learning about the important people of the city. Between her two professions, she's amassed quite a lot of wealth, which is invested in properties in many other cities. Tathlas has lingered longer than usual in her current city primarily because it offers her a steady supply of arriving outlanders. Thus, when she's between jobs, she can indulge her love of slaying by ambushing lone strangers no one will ever miss. Another reason she stays is the presence of an old local wizard who is gradually sinking into his dotage. He mutters his days away over books of magic, shut away in his golem-guarded tower, never noticing that a lithe thief, who can become serpent when she wants to hide, has found a way over the rooftops into his loftier windows, and thence into his trophy rooms. In these littered, seldom visited chambers lie many relics of monsters that can be discreetly harvested for sale as arcane material components. Furthermore, a pearly white ion stone and a crystal ball with detect thoughts are hidden in a little box on the upper shelf. Tathlass has not yet taken these items away with her, preferring to sneak in and use them whenever she wishes. No less than 3 closets in this warren of cluttered rooms offer her the option of locking herself away to use these items, and one has bolts on the inside of the door that she keeps oiled to ensure silent operation. Tathlass has no interest in making enemies of adventurers who might mount a determined campaign to hunt her down. If at all possible, she poses as a human victim of thieves, kidnappers, or slavers should she unexpectedly encounter PCs. Pretending to be bewildered about how she got into the sewer, cellar, or dungeon labyrinth where they found her, she acts frightened but eager to get out. If PCs do rescue her, she offers them free body painting and tattooing at her shop and treats them well, if they accept. Thereafter, however, she uses the wizard's crystal ball to keep a close watch on their activities, since adventurers have a habit of turning up wealth and items of interest to a thief. Rather than stealing directly from them, however, she tries to ensure that the city authorities take them into custody for some real or suspected crime. Then, while they're occupied with explaining themselves, she swoops down on their loot. Death attack. If Tathlass can study the target creature for 3 rounds and then successfully deliver a sneak attack in the next 3 rounds, she can either kill the victim or paralyze it for 1d6 plus 1 rounds. Alternate form. Tathlass can psionically assume the form of a tiny to large viper. This ability is similar to a polymorph spell, but she does not regain any hit points for changing form, and she can assume only viper forms. She gains the viper bite attack and poison special attack. Detect poison. Tathlass can detect poison as the spell, level 6 at will. Poison use. Tathlass is trained in the use of poison and never risks accidentally poisoning herself when applying poison to a blade. Description. Tathlass looks like a lithe, slender human female. Her smooth, dusky skin is a perfect counterpoint for her black hair and dark eyes. The only hints of her serpentine nature are her forked tongue, pointed teeth, and a few scales along the nape of her neck and spine. Though her long hair usually covers these scales, she further conceals them with a hyena dye tattoo of ornate scales etched in many monster heads. She reapplies the design every few months using her professional skills and a set of angled mirrors. Should anyone notice and remark on the design, Tathlass passes it off as a slave brand burned into her flesh years ago by a cruel slaver who kidnapped her. Fortunately, she claims her kin hunted him down and slew him before his caravan could reach the rich slave markets he was heading for. Nagas. The Scaleless One generally regard Naga with a mixture of dread and awe. Some humanoids are drawn to serve and worship the serpentine masters of the art, while others wisely fear the insidious slithering threat they pose. Overview. All Nagas are seen as potentially dangerous and regarded with suspicion throughout Faerun, whether their inherent nature is beneficial, neutral, or malign. The truth is more complex and nuanced. The Maharishul Kensaruk created Nagas to serve as loyal guardians, researchers into the arcane arts, and agents of exploration. Over time, the original Nagas fragmented into myriad subraces, each with its own abilities. Now, millennia after the Saruk dispatched their creations to the far corners of Faerun, Nagas can be found almost everywhere, although most still dislike cold climes. Although they continue to follow their ancient drives, the decline of the Saruk has enabled them to do so in service of their own ends rather than those of their creators. Nagas are natural, potent spellcasters born with an inherent understanding of the art. Regardless of their nature or loyalties, all Nagas are crafty, cunning, and charismatic enough to dominate lesser races through force of personality alone. Most are naturally curious, loyal to a fault, and unusually skilled at deductive reasoning. Beyond these basic traits, their attitudes and goals differ by subrace as well as by individual. Dark Nagas prefer to plot and scheme, forming calculated alliances with other evil creatures so as to gather prey and wealth more efficiently. The serenely wise Guardian Nagas concern themselves primarily with preserving beauty and goodness. Iridescent Nagas are itinerant wanderers, constantly seeking new discoveries and hidden beauty in the world. Spirit Nagas, on the other hand, see only evil and ugliness, and they seek to do harm wherever they can. The bad-tempered and mischievous Water Nagas tend to lash out if threatened, but otherwise they prefer to withdraw from the world at large. Of the minor Naga races, Banaklar Nagas are the cruelest, most cunning, and most desirous of magic and power. Bone Nagas, undead creatures consumed with hatred and malice, detest servitude above all else, but they are otherwise akin to the Nagas they once were. Ha Nagas revel in their own devastating prowess, seeing all other creatures as lesser beings that should bow down before them. Naga Hydras are fearsome predators that haunt the depths of the darkest forests and prey on lesser races. Description: a Naga has a long snake-like body covered with glistening scales and a more or less human face. A typical specimen ranges in length from 10 to 20 feet and weighs between 200 and 500 pounds. But Nagas 100 feet or more in length, such as the largest Ha Nagas, are also known. The eyes of a Naga are bright and intelligent, burning with an almost hypnotic light. Major Naga subraces. The major subraces are all quite distinctive in appearance, despite their general similarity of form. Dark Naga. This creature has a deep purple eel-like body covered in fine scales. Its tail ends in a barbed stinger and its head resembles an eel's, except that it has a human-like visage. Their statistics are found on page 191 of the Monster Manual. Guardian Naga. A Guardian Naga looks like a snake with a beautiful human face. Its body is covered with green-gold scales that exude a sweet floral scent. A gold frill extends from the top of its head to the tip of its tail. See page 192 in the Monster Manual. Iridescent Naga. This gentle creature gets its name from the fine, mirror-like scales that cover its body, radiating a scintillating array of colors whenever it moves. Its head is only vaguely human, and it has colorful feathers in lieu of hair. A frill of silver feathers extends from its neck down to its tail. Iridescent Naga's statistics are given on page 76. Spirit Naga. Cloaked in the cloying stink of carrion, this creature looks as foul as it smells. The black body of a spirit Naga is banded in swaths of bright crimson, and stringy hair hangs limply from its vaguely human head. The Monster Manual describes them in page 192. Water Naga. The Water Naga is covered with emerald green scales in reticulated patterns that run the length of its body. Fiery red and orange spines jut out along its spine from the base of its vaguely human head to the tip of its tail. Their statistics can be found on page 192 of the Monster Manual. Minor Naga subraces. The minor subraces of Naga kind are even more bizarre in appearance than the major ones. Banaklar Naga. This foul creature has a dark purple, green, snake-like body that ends in a dull brown tail. A ring of tiny tentacles surrounds its mouth, and a pair of green-white glistening eyes is set deep in its oversized humanoid head. See page 72 for their statistics. Bone Naga. Once a Naga of a different kind, this undead horror has been reduced to a serpentine skeleton with a bone tail stinger. Its skull is human-like except for its long fangs and the cold, cruel light that burns within its empty eye sockets. The template appears on page 76. Faerunian Ha Naga. This creature's scales have no set color. Rather, they take on hues to match their environment. A Ha Naga's head is that of a classically beautiful human man or woman. For more information, see page 75. Naga Hydra. A Naga Hydra is a monstrous snake-like creature with multiple human-like heads. Its scales are multi-hued and arranged in a reticulated pattern. and a thicket of fiery red and orange spines juts from its body along each of its backbones. Their statistics appear on page 76. Racial history. Nagas were created by the Saruk in the early days of Mihalishuk. Like the Yuan-Ti, the Nagas were the products of magical interbreeding that combined the bodies of powerful serpents with the natural intelligence and inquisitiveness of the human mind. The first Nagas produced were water Nagas, bred specifically to explore Abertoril for their increasingly withdrawn masters. Only beings such as these could explore both on land and below the sea. Approximately -33500 DR, while Saruk ruled Mihalishuk slowly declined. The heart of the empire increasingly became the preserve of the Yuan-Ti. The unexplored territories beyond its periphery, however, attracted the Nagas, who made longer and longer forays into the wilderness. By -24000 DR, when Yuan-Ti ruled Mihalishuk fell, the Nagas had almost wholly withdrawn from their ancient homeland and scattered all across Faerun. In the millennia that followed, many Nagas became individually powerful in Faerun, but they never came together to forge a great civilization of their own. Najara, centered on the Serpent Hills and the Forest of Worms, is the closest thing to a powerful Naga empire that has ever existed on Toril. Nagas have always ruled the Kingdom of Snakes. The bulk of its populace consists of Ophidians, and most of the day-to-day governance is conceded to the Yuan-Ti of the Hisafi tribe. Indeed, only the subtle influence of these Yuan-Ti has enabled Najara to survive as long as it has. The Naga lands south of Vilhon Reach constitute a more typical example of the kind of anarchical, individually focused society that Nagas naturally form on their own. After the fall of Yuan-Ti ruled Mihalishuk, different Naga bloodlines began to favor certain inherent traits more than others, and in time five major Naga subraces evolved: Dark Nagas, Guardian Nagas, Iridescent Nagas, Spirit Nagas, and Water Nagas. Some Dark and Spirit Nagas sought out ancient rituals of the Saruk and transformed themselves into beings of immense power known as Ha Nagas. A few Water Nagas sought to reverse the racial fragmentation, but the result was the creation of the creatures now called Naga Hydras. The minor subraces known as Bonelar Nagas and Bane Nagas both appear within the past two millennia. The former resulted from a magical ritual that the followers of Bane employed on Water Nagas, and the latter were the products of Dark Naga experimentation in the Ebon Arts of Necromancy. Outlook. Nagas are inherently curious about the world in general, and magic in particular. They hold the pursuit of knowledge and understanding above all other goals, and the art above all other forms of study. While they can see the strategic advantages of consulting a large library of wizard spells, or entreating a deity for divine support, most Nagas see the art as a natural extension of the mortal form. Thus, they tend to view sorcery as the perfect embodiment of natural magic. Most Nagas view the preservation of cultural achievements as a worthy goal, regardless of the race that developed them. Thus, Nagas of all subraces willingly seek that which has been lost and guard the remains of fallen civilizations. Even Ha Nagas and Spirit Nagas, which formerly revel in destruction, like to lair amidst the ruins of lost cities or even the remains of temples, castles, or other edifices that they themselves have destroyed. Most Nagas see their own limbless physical form as the philosophical ideal for a true explorer and scholar. They view the use of physical limbs to manipulate the environment as symptomatic of a lesser mind that has been diverted from the true understanding. According to some Naga philosophies, the lesser races constitute the limbs of a metaphysical body in which the Naga is the brain. Thus, the pairing of Nagas with lesser servitors constitutes a perfect melding of mind and body. Naga society. Each Naga calls members of its own subrace Najasara, a nuanced term loosely translated as embodiments of the ideal. They call members of other Naga subraces Najasina, shadows of the ideal. Young Nagas of any kind are known as Nagara. although that term has acquired a secondary meaning that encompasses the ruling Dark Naga caste of Najara. Bone Nagas and rarer undead Nagas are called Najaseinsa, eternal shadows of the ideal. Nagas never speak in the first person singular, preferring instead the royal we. An individual Naga of any kind always refers to itself as San Naja, we the ideal. Members of lesser races are termed Distrasara, hands of the embodiment, while more powerful creatures are called Sethesisa, teachers worthy of emulating. Social hierarchy. As noted previously, Nagas of all kinds are fiercely independent creatures. They have no concept of equal rank, and hence no word for peer. Each Naga considers itself perfect and other members of its subrace as nearly so. Relationships. Although some Nagas are perceived as male or female, including curiously all Naga deities, all are actually hermaphrodites. As such, each Naga is capable of both self-impregnation and copulation with another of its subrace to fertilize the eggs of both. Since neither form of reproduction is particularly favored over the other, convenience and individual preference dictate how and when any given Naga reproduces. This flexibility also means that the concept of mate does not have the same importance to a Naga as it does to most other creatures. Life cycle. Each Naga lays its eggs in its own lair and tends them until they hatch. Young Nagas are fed and trained by their parent, and the Nagara instinctively work together until they are strong enough to survive on their own. At that point, the parent simply leaves the lair for good and seeks out a new one. Organization. Though Nagas have little in the way of social structure, they do understand the concept of the Sasangisna, or nest. Originally, the Sagrasisna encompassed only egg mates, since Nagara of the same hatching must work together to survive until they reach adulthood. Over time, however, this concept has been extended to encompass small groups of allied adult Nagas who agree to work together toward a common set of goals. Eventually, such societal evolution may lead to Naga tribes, but for now, Nagas rarely work in groups of more than 3 or 4, and then only for limited periods of time. Occasionally, a powerful outside influence, such as an individual Ferim or a group of Yuan-Ti working in concert, can forge much larger bands of Nagas. But such social structures persist only as long as outside pressure is applied to maintain them. The longevity of the Kingdom of Snakes is due in large part to the subtle influence of the Hisafi tribe, whose leaders have held the ruling Nagas together for centuries. Their technique consists of strictly indoctrinating the ruling class with a concept of the greater nest and referring to its members as Nagara. In this way, they continually reinforce the notion that the Nagas must continue working together with others for their nest. Naga characters. The typical Naga is a natural master of the art, exhibiting inherent spellcasting powers equivalent to those of a 7th level or higher spellcaster. Banelard Nagas are notable exceptions to this rule. Although Nagas can advance by gaining additional hit dice, mature individuals who have traveled far and wide can also advance via class levels, although most do not survive long enough to do so. The favorite class for such Naga is either Sorcerer or Bard, and their favorite class of Banelard Nagas are Cleric and Wizard. For the purpose of spellcasting, a Naga is considered to have virtual levels, at least one spellcasting class that stack with any actual levels it has in the same class. For example, a typical Dark Naga casts spells as a 7th level sorcerer, though it has none of the other abilities of such a character, such as the ability to summon a familiar. A Dark Naga that acquired one sorcerer level would be a Dark Naga Sorcerer 1 who casts spells as an 8th level sorcerer, though he would function as a 1st level sorcerer in all other respects, including familiar benefits. Some Nagas can treat spells from the cleric spell list, and certain domain spell lists are arcane spells, and can choose them as spells known if desired. For such Nagas, gaining additional levels in the class it uses for spellcasting also gives it access to higher level cleric and domain spells. For example, a typical spirit Naga cast as a 7th level sorcerer, and thus no 3rd level cleric spells and 3rd level spells from the chaos and evil domains as arcane spells. If that spirit Naga acquires one sorcerer level, it can then cast spells as an 8th level sorcerer, and thus has access to 4th level cleric and domain spells. Nagas do not receive the granted powers of their domains. Magic and the Nagas. Nagas are natural spellcasters, and the breadth and depth of their experimentation with the art rivals that of any other race. Because their ancestors helped the Saruk establish the foundations of magic in Istasafifil, Miharishuk, and Okoth, modern-day Nagas have a deep understanding of the history of the art and the context in which magical advances have been made. Because of their natural affinity for research, a Naga gains a +4 racial bonus on spellcraft checks made to develop a new spell. Moreover, a Naga does not require access to a well-stocked library to pursue such a project. Although Nagas experiment with and employ all types of spells, they are masters of divination and guile. Thus, they tend to favor spells from the school of divination, enchantment, and illusion. Dark Nagas in particular favor arcane eye, arcane sight, charm monster, charm person, command, confusion, disguise, etc. Many Nagas are skilled in the art of creating magic items. They invariably favor objects that they can employ in their natural forms, so items worn over the eyes, lenses, goggles, and masks on the head, or around the neck are common. Painlar Nagas also utilize rings, rods, and wands that they can employ with the tentacles that grow around their mouths. Naga deities. When the Saruk created the Naga race, Miharishuk was a monotheistic society that acknowledged and venerated only the world serpent. All other claimants to the mantle of divinity were viewed as blasphemous heretics. However, the many facets of the world serpent and even other gods intrigued many Nagas, since they were by nature more curious than their creators. Some theologians now claim it was the endless questioning of the world serpent by the Naga race that caused the great scale one to fragment into a host of lesser deities. While others insist that the Nagas were simply the first to recognize the world serpent's impending fragmentation. Whatever the cause, sages agree that the breakup of the world serpent established the resulting deities to better address the myriad contradictory demands of its worshippers. Of all the emergent aspects of the Great Scaled One, two deities in particular attracted the worship of most Nagas, Shastrun and Shekinster. The former embodied the principles of curiosity, destruction, and possessiveness that had precipitated the world serpent's fragmentation. The latter, known as the Naga Queen, became the keeper of the knowledge and wisdom originally held by the world serpent, preserved within the eternal flame that she guarded. After the fall of Maharishuk, both Sehestrun and Jazirian, another fragment of the world serpent, began to court Sheikster. The Naga Queen eventually chose Jazirian and became pregnant by him. Enraged by this decision, Sheharistun attacked Shenister, and she was forced to swallow him. In doing so, the Naga Queen took into herself the same destructive element that had fragmented the world serpent in the first place. As a result, she acquired 5 guises: the Acquirer, the Empowerer, the Seeker, the Weaver, and the Preserver. This event was accompanied by a 5-fold division in the Naga race, forming the 5 major sub-races now known as Dark Nagas, Guardian Nagas, Iridescent Nagas, Spirit Nagas, and Water Nagas. Upon giving birth to Parafire, the Naga prince Shenister expelled Sharistun's remains and instructed her offspring to hide away the destructive force that the corpse embodied forever, so that her 5-fold aspect could not actually divide her into 5 separate goddesses. Parafire complied with her wishes, and now both he and his mother are venerated as guardians of the Naga race. An individual Naga who worships Shenister typically embraces one aspect of the goddess wholly, but gives homage to all her other guises as well. The 5-faced queen does not have an organized church, and she largely eschews clerical support. Embracing the magical heritage that runs in the bloodlines of her followers, Shenister allows some Nagas to access divine powers through arcane spellcasting. See Deities of the Scaled Ones in the appendix for more information. Other deities venerated by the Nagas. The following deities also have significant Naga followings. Bane, the Black Lord. Although Bane is part of the Faerûnian pantheon venerated primarily by humans, many Bane-lar Nagas are also drawn to the tyranny of the Black Lord. According to legend, Bane once taught his human followers the rediscovered ritual for transforming water Nagas into Bane-lar Nagas, thus ensuring himself a loyal following within this minor Naga subrace. Many Bane-lar Nagas that had strayed to the faiths of Sirik and Yachuzim during Bane's absence from the pantheon have since returned to the Black Lord's fold, swelling the ranks of his followers once again. Bane-lar Nagas that ally with priests of Bane are considered mid-level priests in the church hierarchy, with all the attendant privileges and duties stemming from such a ranking. Further information about the Black Lord can be found in Faiths and Pantheons. Sirik, the Dark Sun. During the 14 years that Bane was dead, a large number of Bane-lar Nagas forged alliances with the Church of Sirik in order to further their own evil ends. Since Bane's return, however, most of them have gone back to their traditional faith. The remaining Sirik's Bane-lar Nagas tend to be the neutral evil or chaotic evil alignment, and they are actively hunted by followers of the Black Lord. Further information about the Dark Sun can be found in Faiths and Pantheons. Relations with other races. Nagas are extremely conscious of their status among the various sentient and magic-wielding races of Eren. They view most other creatures as beneath them and in need of leadership, education, or complete domination. This belief leads many dark and spirit Nagas to establish small cults of servitors who worship them as divine entities, and many guardian and iridescent Nagas to become teachers and guides for those who would benefit from their insight and wisdom. Conversely, many Nagas willingly serve beings with potent internal magic that exceeds their own mastery of the art, including dragons, Faerims, Saruk, Shard, and certain Yuan-Ti. Nagas have far less difficulty leading large numbers of lesser creatures than they do interacting with others of their own kind, since subservient creatures do not challenge their sense of individuality. An evil Naga mastermind attended by a cult of worshippers perceives itself as effective alone, with the lesser races acting as a tool or physical extensions of its will. Likewise, a good aligned Naga teacher attended by a band of disciples also perceives itself as alone, with the lesser races serving as empty containers in which to store its wisdom. Such narcissistic racial perceptions give rise to a complete intolerance for disloyalty. After all, a creature should be able to direct its own limbs without fearing argument or betrayal. Naga equipment. Nagas use little in the way of mundane equipment. A few have armor specifically designed for their sinuous bodies, but most shun it because it inhibits their movement. Weapons are useless to Nagas, since they have no manipulative appendages. Naga encounters. Player characters can encounter individual Nagas almost anywhere, often supported by cults or small groups of followers. Both human cities and remote locations can hide Naga lairs, though good aligned Nagas often make the location of their lairs public so they can direct the activities of their followers openly. Ready to use villains and allies. Nagas often pursue prestige classes of various kinds, particularly those that enhance their spellcasting ability. The Naga characters presented below can be woven into adventures or encountered individually. Maharishi, Seer of Procolith. Maharishi lairs amidst the ruins of Procolith at the western end of the Dolphin Gulf in the shadow of the Dolphin Mountains. Known as the Seer of Procolith, the wise guardian Naga has made the study of the Saruk and Yuan-Ti its life's work, focusing especially on their history and magic. Thus, the Naga has become known far and wide as a skilled diviner and sage of all things serpentine. Adventurers of all stripes seek out Maharishi before delving into the Black and Mihar jungles, knowing that the information it can provide may mean the difference between life and death in the heartlands of the Yuan-Ti. Those who survive such treks often pay the mysterious oracle a second visit upon their return to find out which of the artifacts they have discovered are valuable and which bear fell curses of the Yuan-Ti. Maharishi's actual lair has never been found. Those who seek the Naga simply camp out for a night in the ruined city, putting to papyrus a summary of their questions or laying out the items. they wish to have examined. Thereafter they rest normally and do not resist scrying attempts. If the seer of Brocolith is willing to grant them an audience, it appears before them. Poison. Bite or sting, injury or contact. Fortitude DC 19, initial and secondary damage, 1d10 constitution. Spells. Maharishi casts spells as a level 9th sorcerer, and can also cast spells from the cleric list and from the good and law domains as arcane spells. Spit. Maharishi can spit its venom, see poison above, up to 30 feet as a standard action. Spitting is a ranged touch attack with no range increment. Greater lore. Maharishi can understand magic items as though with an identify spell. Lore. Maharishi knows legends or information regarding various topics and can retrieve it just as Bard can with bardic knowledge. It has a plus 16 bonus on its lore check. Secrets. Maharishi knows the lore of true stamina, secret knowledge of avoidance, weapons trick, dodge trick, and applicable knowledge. Ebernaj, King of Najara. Ebernaj, the reigning king of snakes, is a powerful dark naga who claimed the unique naga crown known as the Marl Spire of Najara in the year of the Orm Serpent 1295 DR, after the untimely death of the previous ruler. The Serpentine Monarch lairs in the snake pit of Sakarhanja, attended by Guardian of Najara and a half dozen spirit nagas. Although Ebernaj is personally quite powerful, its authority stems primarily from its strength of personality and its ability to inspire serpent folk of Najara. The current King of Snakes is patient, but much more ambitious than its immediate predecessors. Ebernaj backed the formation of the Cult of the Dark Naga, see Najara in Chapter 7, in hopes of adding to the store of spells and magic available to Najara's elite. But it has yet to reveal what it intends to do upon acquiring such an arsenal. The King of Snakes also backs plans to subvert a village of Serpent's Cow by slow and steady means, and to regain control of the ruined city of Satharhinsun and reclaim it as Najara's capital. Ebernaj reached its current position by forging alliances with care and by pitting its underlings and rivals against one another. It shows no sign of abandoning such tactics now, even though they might actually hinder the achievement of its goals. Ebernaj, King of Najara, Advanced Dark Naga Sorcerer. Skills and feats. Enslave. Ebernaj can attempt to enslave any one living creature within 30 feet. The target must succeed a DC 32 will save or be affected as though by a dominant person spell. An enslaved creature obeys Ebernaj's telepathic commands until freed by Remove Curse, and can attempt a new will save every 24 hours to break free. The control is also broken if Ebernaj dies or travels more than 1 mile from its slave. Poison. Bite or spit, injury or contact, Fortitude DC 28, or lapse into a nightmare-haunted sleep for 2d4 minutes. Spells. Ebernaj casts spells as a 15th level sorcerer. Tap Slave. Once per day, Ebernaj can leech the life force of any one enslaved follower within 1 mile, as if using the Vampiric Touch spell, except that it need not actually touch the target. Augment Followers 1 and 2. Detect Thoughts. Ebernaj can continuously use Detect Thoughts as the spell caster level 9th DC 28 negates. This ability is always active. Guarded Thoughts. Ebernaj is immune to any form of mind reading. Resistance to charm. Ebonage has a 2 racial bonus on saving throws against all charm effects. Terpenzi, the guardian of Najara. The bone Hanaga, known as Terpenzi, was the founder and the first ruler of Najara, the kingdom of snakes. After its death in battle against the Shadow King during the waning days of the Sathari Sun, its remains were converted into a bone Naga, and it guarded the abandoned city of fountains for millennia. During its long unlife, it gained considerable power as a Naga overlord. See chapter 12. Today, Terpenzi is the sinister guardian of Najara, enslaved to the will of each successive Dark Naga king by the Marl Spire of Najara. The Bone Hanaga is utterly loyal to both the realm it founded and the monarch who wears Najara's crown, though it constantly presses against the magical strictures that enforce its loyalty to the leader of the Nagara. To that end, Terpenzi engages in decades-long plots to undermine the rule of the Nagara without betraying the reigning king. Most of these plots involve inducing adventurous scaleless ones to wage daring assaults on the ruling Nagara and destroy the Marl Spire of Najara, an item that they have been led to believe threatens the safety of Western Faerun. Terpenzi, the guardian of Najara, Bone Faerunian Hanaga Overlord 10 CR 33, Colossal Undead, Augmented Aberration. Skills and Feats. Augment Followers 1, 2, and 3. Charming Gaze. Terpenzi's gaze functions like the mass charm spell against creatures within 90 feet. Will DC 35 negates. Constrict. Terpenzi deals 4d6 plus 12 points of damage with a successful grapple attack against a huge or smaller opponent. Enslave. Terpenzi can attempt to enslave any one living creature within 30 feet. The target must succeed on a DC 40 will save, or be affected as though by a dominant monster spell caster level 10. An enslaved creature obeys Terpenzi's telepathic commands until freed by Remove Curse, and can attempt a new will saving every 24 hours to break free. The control is also broken if Terpenzi dies or travels more than 1 mile from its slave. Poison. Bite 42 DC 33. Initial and secondary damage 1d4 strength. Sting 42 DC 33. Initial and secondary damage 2d8 constitution. Spells. Terpenzi can cast spells as a 34th level sorcerer, and can choose spells from the cleric list and from the chaos and evil domains. The cleric spells and domain spells are considered arcane spells for him. Tap Slave. 3 times per day, Terpenzi can leech the life force of any one enslaved follower within 1 mile of it using the vampiric touch spell, except that it need not actually touch the target. Chameleon Ability. Terpenzi blends in with its surroundings, gaining a +8 circumstance bonus on high checks. Flight. Terpenzi can fly as though with a fly spell at 120 feet, with perfect maneuverability. This ability grants him a +6 circumstance bonus on move silently checks when flying. Telepathy. Terpenzi can communicate telepathically with any creature within 250 feet that has a language. Undead traits. Terpenzi is immune to mind-influencing effects, poison, sleep effects, paralysis, stunning, disease, death effects, and any effect that requires a fortitude save unless it also works on objects or is harmless. It is not subject to critical hits, non-lethal damage, ability damage, to its physical ability scores, ability drain, energy drain, fatigue, exhaustion, or death from massive damage. It cannot be raised, and resurrection works only if it is willing. Dark vision 60 feet.